And I'd like to introduce the returnable pallet standard in Asia, being developed in APSF organization. The APSF, Asia Pallet System Federation, the reason why we put the system in the name of the APSF, because the pallet itself is not enough for universal system in logistics. Not only for pallet, but also other transport returnable items. For example, a rolling pallet, or crates, and box pallet, and even information systems will be attached to the APSF pallet system. That is why we call it Asia Pallet System Federation. So the objective is to enhance the member countries' logistics service and efficiency by means of pallet standardizations, which we call it a palletization and unit load systems, which is linking with the palletization and containerizations. So to reduce the logistics cost by identifying the returnable pallet for a customs free process while being across the board when they are import or exports. The products are being loaded on the pallet. So in that case, if it is returned, it is imported, and then, you know, we need to have an exemption for customs, taxes. I would like to introduce a little bit about what is the containerizations. As Mr. Sir, chair of the KPCA, has already talked about a little bit about Malcolm McLean. He is the one who pioneered to develop the containerizations at first time. And I'd like to show you a short period of a video clip showing that how he has been struggling in developing the container in marine ocean.
Nearly everything we buy is made overseas. No matter where you live, it's likely that the majority of products you use on a daily basis are made outside your own country's borders. Even at the supermarket, it's common to see fresh food that was grown or caught on the other side of the world. Not long ago, this would have been unheard of. Everything had to be produced close to the consumer. It just wasn't profitable to ship goods over long distances. Only luxury and specialty items were shipped from overseas. Very few commonplace items were produced more than a couple hundred miles away from the final market. That all changed on April 26, 1956, when the Ideal X, a converted World War II tanker, left Newark, New Jersey on its main journey. What was so special about this journey was that it was the first time in history that a ship had its cargo packed into containers rather than just loosely placed around its holds. This seems like a simple and uninfluential concept, but this idea changed our world. Before the Ideal X, cargo was brought to port in trucks and loaded onto ships piece by piece. Whiskey and rice and hammers and everything was packed tightly into the hold, and the whole loading process took more than a week. This technique, known as break bulk cargo, dated back to the time of the Phoenicians. It was said that dock workers' wages were $20 a day and all the scotch you could carry home because theft of goods was so rampant. This needed to change. Malcolm McLean, a trucking company owner, sold everything he owned to buy a ship and develop the system of containerization. Unbearably simple, he designed a corrugated steel box and created some trucks and a ship that would seamlessly hold these boxes. This connected the manufacturer straight to the consumer. Manufacturers would load these boxes, then no hands would touch the merchandise until the container was delivered to the vendor, distributor, or consumer. One of the most amazing aspects of this system is that it became universal.
If you look at this slide, that shows you that how the unit systems are working with inside of the containers. So that forklift truck with holding the a unit system, which is palletization, is fit into the ocean freight containers. It is very important to have a same size in freight container. So they have developed a standardization of dimension of the size of the containers.
So we can't even agree on a currency, plug type, DVD standard, or even which side of the road to drive on. But we can agree across the world on the one size of shipping container. A container loaded in Kansas will fit on the train that takes it to the dock, then fit on the boat that takes it to China, then fit on the truck that will take it up to Russia.
Which we call it intermodal or multimodal transportation.
Even some planes are now being designed to fit intermodal containers. There's no need for logistics, no need for calculations, no need for worrying if the container will work in faraway countries. But what really changed our world was how quick this system made the loading process of a ship. What used to take more than a week could now be done in a matter of hours. Shipping costs plummeted after the introduction of this system. Whole cities such as Newark and Oakland were put on the map because of their new, larger ports that were needed in response to the shipping boom. This system also helped create the global economy that we have today, one where one car has elements from dozens of countries across the world. It's now cheaper to manufacture many goods on the other side of the world because shipping is so inexpensive. Containerization was the greatest driver of the development of a global economy and trade network. The intermodal container cut shipping time from Europe to Australia down from 70 to 34 days without increasing the speed of travel. We are still witnessing the aftermath of this innovation today. Between 1993 and 2002, the average distance of a cargo shipment grew by 40%. This means that goods are still being manufactured farther and farther away from their market. The value per ton of cargo is also dropping. More and more cheap items are being shipped from far away to be sold. However, many believe that containerization, 50 knots is the average speed today for cargo ships, and it's unlikely that this speed will increase in the near future. To make shipping faster and cheaper, one needs to find other ways to speed up the process. There are some small changes being developed, such as the automation of ports and further specialization of ships. However, the greatest innovation for shipping may come from the greatest threat to mankind. Global warming is opening new routes for shipping. The once frozen Northeast Passage north of Scandinavia and Russia now can be sailed on for a few months of the year. In 2009, a German cargo ship became the first commercial vessel to sail this route. And today, multiple ships use this route every year.
You can see the destination from South Korea to European countries route the North Atlantic oceans.
The route shortens the shipping time between Europe and Asia by days, avoids the pirate-infested waters of the Red Sea and Gulf of Aden, and saves on average $300,000 in fuel per vessel per voyage. So there you have it. That's how a metal box changed our world. Without that box, we wouldn't have our phones from China, our clothes from Bangladesh, or even our oranges from Florida. Shipping is a behind-the-scenes process that has made our world what it is today. Our economy and our lives would not be the same without this innovation. Containerization may be little.
So that means that containerization is very important in trading. For looking for the efficiency and effectiveness of the logistics cost. He is the pioneer of the world trade promotion, Mr. McLean, and another pioneer from South Korea, Mr. Seo, has proposed a foldable container, which reduces your logistics cost one-fourth. So that means a lot to the transportation between oceans in trading. So let me go back, let me forward to the... Let me introduce how the APSF organization looks like. There are 10 member countries, including obviously Thailand, and recently Myanmar has participated as a key members. So among 10 member countries, we are cooperating closely each other in terms of standardization of the pallet and mineral systems. So I'd like to show a short slideshow of that describing the a history of APSF. I think you have in the booklet, we published this one, a 10-year history of APSF. We published it last year. And I will show the contents of the a book. This is about the history of 10 years of ASF. Here in vision, there are another platforms which they call it a platform economy. So if you look at the slide here, in 2008, it is the rent by a stock market capitalization. Capitalization number one in 2008 was petrochemical China, and Exxon, and General Electric, and China Mobile. And those are the petrochemicals and banks. And then they have been changed. Someone like Apple is number one in respect to the stock market capitalizations. Now they are over $1 trillion in market capitalizations. And then the Amazon has already achieved $1 trillion. So those are the companies that are developing the platform economy. So what I mean by platform economy is a big change in the way the industry has traditionally been organized. So first mover advantage is very important. So the secret behind why the platform economy is very popular and very dominant is that the platform leverage network effect. What I mean by network effect is if you have two phones, you need to have only one interaction. And if you have five phones, it will increase interaction of 10. And then 12 phones, 66 interaction. What I mean by interaction is transaction, is business transaction will be applied. So it will increase exponentially and dramatically the size of the interaction or the size of the transactions. So that's why the first mover can be a dominant economy. And let me explain about the traditional one is the pipe one, and the platform is the new one. That platform is an environment generally owned by company, by their customers, almost becomes a supplier by adding additional value to the company's own products. For example, Amazon and marketplaces is the outstanding example of the platform economy. So in logistics, why do we necessary to have a platform in a logistics industries? So we will be able to build a platform a business in logistics as well. So Amazon, let me show how the Amazon Go, that is the offline convenience store, may soon change the way we shop and the way we implementing the logistics functions. So let me show you the one that how the Amazon goes.
Four years ago, we started to wonder, what would shopping look like if you could walk into a store, grab what you want, and just go? What if we could weave the most advanced machine learning, computer vision, and AI into the very fabric of a store so you never have to wait in line? No lines, no checkouts, no registers. Four years ago, we started to wonder, what would shopping look like? What would shopping look like If you could walk into a store, grab what you want, and just go. What if we could weave the most advanced machine learning, computer vision, and AI into the very fabric of a store, so you never have to wait in line? No lines, no checkouts, no registers.
So Amazon Go developed the convenience store.
Use the Amazon
Go app. Without having a cashier.
Then put away your phone and start shopping. It's really that simple. Take whatever you like. Anything you pick up is automatically added to your virtual cart. If you change your mind about that cupcake, just put it back. Our technology will update your virtual cart automatically. So, how does it work? We used computer vision, deep learning algorithms, and sensor fusion, much like you'd find in self-driving cars. We call it Just Walk Out technology. Once you've got everything you want, you can just go. When you leave, our Just Walk Out technology adds up your virtual cart and charges your Amazon account. Your receipt is sent straight to the app, and you can keep going. Amazon Go. No lines, no checkout. No, seriously.
So as the retailers are developing using the high technology, machine learning, artificial intelligence, and big data, and so in line with the logistics needs also be developed to support the retailers that Amazon goes like that. So I'm going to show another video. As you may know, Alibaba is the offline stores, and they are performing outstandingly.
I am in Shanghai visiting Alibaba's new retail
store. Not only is the tech titan expanding, but this location is the first with its own robot restaurant too.
Robots are actually delivering pretty much all the food.
So that's what I'll end up after the shopping experience. The Hema store is growing rapidly in China, opening 65 locations in 1 year. There's three pillars to its strategy, serving as a place to shop in person, a distribution center for online orders, and the restaurant. It's hoping to define what the future of retail will look like. While I'm checking this out, I might as well grab a basket.
See what interests me. First thing I noticed is the pricing system. Every price tag has a barcode in which you can use the Hema app to scan the barcode and then see the price of the item online. You can also see reviews of that product. What's also fascinating is that even though these price tags look like they were printouts, it's actually a special technology that can change the price in real time.
And that's not all. It even tells you when it was delivered to the store and where it came from. You can also see a scan of a government certificate proving, for instance, if it was organic. It also shows delivery options if you decide not to buy it in store.
I just saw a lady who works for the store and she was fulfilling an online order. So using her scanner, she had a bag, she would pick the product, and then what was really crazy is instead of walking across the store to get it where it needs to go, she put it on a conveyor belt, which then took it to the ceiling, to the back area, where then it will then go out for delivery. So essentially now you're talking about not only a retail store, but also a distribution center. And if you live within 3 kilometers of a Hema store, you can have delivery of your groceries within 30 minutes. You see a lot of employees walking around the store, fulfilling orders. I understand how it can maximize efficiency of sourcing, but it creates for a somewhat chaotic experience too when you have a lot of people running around. A lot of sample stations throughout the store.
The reason why I'm showing the retailers, or especially supermarket or convenience store, is that because the retailers are developing very speedily to satisfy their customers. So that logistics should be supporting to retailers. So how the retailers are changing their business model. So that's what we need to understand, or how the retailers are developing. So the platform, the Intel created one is the connected logistics platform. That is very valuable in terms of to support the retailers because they have a smart tag, which is a sensor tag, and it is using the Wi-Fi. You mean the, you know, the global, we have a 5G's, you have or 4 or 5G's, and you can connect with the Wi-Fi with a smart tag and through to the a cloud computing service, for example, Amazon Web Service or Google Cloud Service. You can connect that cloud service for users know what the systems are and how the pallets or how the containers are moving from the manufacturer to the distribution centers. They know exactly where their products are and what condition, for example, temperature and humidities. And those informations are gathering by a smart tag, which is a sensor tag, and that tag connecting with the 3G or 4G or Wi-Fi to the cloud systems. So that is the one that a software platforms. So I'm talking about the two platforms, platform for software and platform for business. With respect to the business model, the platform business model is for the Amazon marketplace, and the one that Intel has developed is a platform for software. They developed a software platform. So Samsung SDS, where I used to work 20 years ago, and they developed a blockchain for a shipping a logistics. And they launched it, and they developed a pilot program with the shipping companies. And I'm trying to talk about the pallet. You see, the standardization is very important with respect to dimension, the size of the pallet, and with respect to the quality of the pallet is important. But what's more important is information system in it. And pallet, it is not anymore a dumb plate. It is not dumb plate. It could be as smart as smartphones. So if you put your sensor tag and linking with the a cloud systems, and we'll be able to track and tracking all the systems, across the systems. So there are many returnable transport items for Uniloads. For example, flat pallet and wall box pallet. All these returnable transport items can be used as a Uniload systems. So that not only for pallet with box, a curtain box, not only for pallet with a crates, and dolly pallet with the crates is one other a unit load system. And pallets with a crates with a looking a nicely in a unit load systems, for example, like this or this. And those are the systems that was coming from the pallet or crates. So those you can coordinate what kind of unit load systems your company is looking for. That is important to know. There are many different kinds of unit loads. So, but in reality, in transporting across the board, when you open your freight containers, you will see this happening due to the problem with the measure of size of the pallet and size the quality of the pallet. Another one is the problem with the dimensions. Why do you think they have a step of the pallet, two step of pallet? Because different size of the pallet from European country to Korea, and they have we have different size of pallet. So that's why they put on the a unit load, a pallet load with only another pallet. So they are the problem. So. For example, like it's bulk load, it's manually, it should be handled manually. So that is another problem with the unit load systems being handled in presently in reality. And let me show you the one that what's in reality. Yes, you can see they are unloading their cotton bag manually. It is happening in South Korea now. So that is what's really happening in retail and logistics environment. So that we need kind of build a systems between the China, Japan, and Korea, a returnable certified pallet by APS in Asia. That is why we stipulate a standard, which is a 1100 by 1100 and 1200 by 1000. And we have two standard size of the pallet stipulated in APSN. So that different size of pallet can no longer be obstacle to promote the trade. So as Dr. Chechan was talking about the customs, and yes, they can do free customs, but the problem is it's very difficult to documentations. So that's the problem. So even though the regulation and laws are enacted, but in reality, you are facing a problem in China too. That is why we need a tracking the pallet, if it is returnable, between crossing the border, and then we need to find the pallet which has been returned from China or from Japan or Thailand. We need to identify their pallet, and then we'll be able to very easily the process for tax-free. So that is why we are trying to do returnable and trackable pallet by using whatever the technology is available. Now RFID is available, and the QR code is available, and sensor tag is available with Wi-Fi. And GS1, we developed and applied GS1 as the communication standard in APSF. As you look at the tariff between South Korea and 6.5% to 8.0%, China is over 13%. So we are looking for eliminate those tariffs by identifying the returnable pallet. That's what we are trying to do, and try to identify using the GS1 system of the standard. And I'm a little bit running out of time. I skipped that one. GS1 is international standard for business models. So we developed the location of the RFID and barcode and RFID pallet. So we developed all the standards required to identify returnable pallet. And protocol of EPC UHS Gen 2 and communication for event data, we developed the systems like that. And then we are applying that the GS1 standard. In GS1 standard, EPCIS is available for interfacing Windows. So we have developed the data requirements in GS1. And the GLN, oops, GLN or GRAI is the standard in GS1. So you know exactly what the grades are if you identify it. And if you identify it, you can capture the data, all the data in here. You can capture it. And after capture your data on pallet, and you can share that data with the stakeholders or other users or third-party logistics providers. So those systems are using with the GS1 as well. So the point I like to emphasize on is that international logistics collaboration is very important in Asian countries. So that is why we are collaborating with the APSF, actually collaborating with China, Japan, Korea, Ministerial Conference, Maritime, and we are cooperating with the ASEAN, APEC systems, to understand what the Unilog system, we are looking for. We need to build a Unilog systems in Asian countries. That's what we are looking for. And I hope we will succeed in a very near future for standard and the information embedded on pallet. Pallet is no more a dumb plate. It should be a smart plate with many valuable information. Thank you very much. Yes, we have a second presentation in afternoon session. Mr. Kenny Tian, the Unilog system in cost reductions in Moscow. Would you please give hands to him?
Good afternoon. When I was asked to present today, I took a very basic approach towards this unit load system, and I think through the presentations that we have heard today from Chairman Sir, Dr. Chai Chan, as well as the other distinguished speakers, I think they've gone through quite a fair bit in terms of what the unit load systems are, you know, where are the visions or where are the aspirations that we are working towards. So what I've done is, my presentation will probably take us slightly backwards towards this, just to explain a little bit about why it's important and what it means to ASEAN as well as APSF going forward. So, the unit load system is actually it sounds very simple, the concept of it. It's basically born as a result of looking for efficiencies and optimization. It basically also at the same time looks at things in terms of how we handle our goods, in terms of how we package our products, and what we actually intend to get out from logistics practices and efficiencies. Now, a lot of this actually relate to products that we move, and most of the products that we actually see are commodities, consumer products, as well as industrial products. The unit load itself is influenced by many things, but mainly it's the characteristic of the products that you ship. It's the nature of it, the dimension, the shape, and very importantly, the weight as well. Now, at the same time, we also look at the environmental issues. There was a presentation by Kun Surasit just now. He mentioned that one of the things that impacts the product as well as the unit load itself is the operating conditions. And for us, that's very important. At the same time, we look at the distribution systems, which is where the products are originating from, what happens in transit, as well as what happens at the receiving point. So to explain it in very short and simple terms, this is what a typical unit load would be. Now, there has been a lot of talk about pallets, and probably that's the specialty of the company that I work for, which is Lawson. But unit loads come in many forms, and now we talk today about mini loads as well. Now, in terms of unit load, the key platform of it is a pallet, and we heard earlier on there's layer 2, layer 3, layer 4. We're talking about containerization. That itself is a unit load system as well. But again, you know, with a simple product like platform, we heard about the evolution of going towards a smart pallet. A smart pallet can be many things. It can be smart as we want it to be. It can be not as smart as we don't want it to be as well. It can be many things. But I think the basic fundamental of it is you have to have a platform. And the most basic platforms that we have on unit load systems is the container as well as the pallet. Now, in Southeast Asia, we tend to talk about a standard which is the T12 standard, 1000 by 1002. But working together with APSF, as has been mentioned earlier on, there are two standards, which is the T11 and the T12. So what are the advantages of unit load? I think we all know this very well, so I won't get into this. But again, there are also disadvantages of unit loads because there is there is also talk that, you know, unit load do not work for all companies. They do not work for all products as well. And that's truth in that. But in anything, it's always what the majority benefits from and, you know, what how the minorities actually try and work towards their own efficiencies at the same time. So the next thing that we talk about is the standardization. We talk about the T11 standard. We talk about the T12 standard in pallets. Now, those are very common standards within the Asian system. In Europe, we've got the 800 by 1200 pallet, which is the European standard. But interestingly enough, in the United Kingdom, they also use a 1000 by 1200 pallet. In America, we have got the imperial size, which is 40 by 48 inches. And in Australia, a totally different standard, again, 1165 millimeters. So you can see, you know, although there has been talk that, you know, there should be standards around. But where you go depends on which country you go, which region you go, again, different standards apply. Now, in Thailand, in Southeast Asia, we tend to see the adoption of, at least, you know, in certain selected industries, certain verticals, we tend to see the adoption of the T12, which is the 1000 by 1200 pallets. And a lot of development towards the packaging of products itself has gone towards how to harmonize some of the packaging to the standard pallets of 1000 by 1002. Now that's very important because when you stack your products on it, you do not want any gaps. And you should be able to also shrink wrap your products when it's moving. And what I'm talking about is palletized shipment as well as palletized cargo. That's one of the things which, you know, Lawson as a company works towards, and that's where we build our efforts towards standardization and towards looking, getting companies to evaluate whether that standardization works for them, and eventually how do they want to move towards that. So typically, again, in Southeast Asia, we tend to see a lot of trucks which varies by country, but T11 and the T12 standard tends to fit into most of these trucks, be they 20-footer or 40-footer containers. We talk about trailers, which are 40-foot long, 45, could be 20-foot long as well. And lorries in some of these smaller distribution points, where it goes out of the capital cities into the smaller provinces and to the smaller outer areas. We tend to have smaller trucks or smaller delivery drop loads. We've got 10-footers, 20-footers, and so on. They tend to also carry pallets of various sizes, but again, are these unit loads and are these palletization being effective or efficient in what they move? Because If you have different standards or palettes, again, you do not get your efficiencies. The next thing that we look at is whether you should own those palettes or you should actually run a system which is returnable. Now, returnable can be working with a palette provider. It can also be working on yourself where you return your own palettes and you manage the forward as well as the reverse logistics of those palettes. Now, it's a lot of work to do that. And most companies these days, if there's an option to actually outsource that element of it, they tend to do that. And the efficiencies are quite clear. Because if you buy your own pallets and if you tend to own your own pallets and if they are one-way pallets, they tend to be more expensive in the longer term. But if you can make a returnable system work for you, either through a provider or through an internal system of managing those pallets, you can actually get the efficiencies of it. So these are the benefits of having a well-defined unit load system and having a standard pallet pool. Now, we talk a lot about efficiencies and optimization, but I think they come in many forms, again, depending on which industry, which sector you are. But in principle, you basically get key things around, the key ones that we notably note always is around streamlining transport services as well as streamlining your packaging design. That's very important because ultimately there's a lot of wastage in that. And all of us know that the key cost around logistics is always transport. It's transport, transport. And it's how we actually maximize transport, be they within domestic shipments or be international shipments as well. So I'll just talk a little bit about Thailand, in terms of what we do as a business. We run a pallet pool in Thailand. And we focus on several sectors, but the biggest one that we actually work on is within the consumer goods and the retail sector. Now, it can be as simple as pallet pooling for us, but don't limit yourself in terms of pallet because there are many equipments that goes between a manufacturer, an integrator, as well as a retailer. This could be, as mentioned earlier on, it could be plastic crates, it could be plastic containers, and it also could be dollies or I think there was a presentation earlier on around what we call a retail-ready packaging item, which is something that comes from the fresh produce supplier and goes straight to the retail floor, where there's minimal handling and minimal touch. Now, all these are unit loads in its own form, but at this point in time, the biggest platform is still pallets. Now, just to give you an idea, and these are statistics which we comb out from our own analysis in our own business. We also tend to see that within the FMCG and the consumer sector itself, the shift, if you like to call it, between the modern trade as well as the traditional trade or the general trade, as well as the other distribution channels available in Thailand, you would see that over a 10 to 15 year period, the growth in that modern trade has been quite exponential. It's grown from in the mid-30s into the high 40% over, and that's represented by the orange bar in the center. And the traditional trade has been slowly declining, and there are reasons for that as well, because what you tend to see now is a consolidation within the retail industry, where the larger players are getting larger, and the smaller players are either being acquired or they are being forced out of the market. So again, the shift has been there, and it's also reflected in what we see happening within palletization as well. This is another picture of it in terms of what we have noticed on unit load palletization going into the modern trade retail sector from slightly above 2 million movements a year. We've gone above 8 million movements a year now. Now, so what does this all mean? In working together with APSF, I think member ASEAN countries as well as Korea, Japan, and China, we know and we've seen a lot because we've dealt with many customers, okay, who move their products within borders. Now, the ABC blueprint, which is what is being worked on within the ASEAN community at this moment, It's a very big and integrated market. We're talking about in excess of 680 million in terms of population. And the fundamental of it is to have a very strong, resilient, and identifiable ASEAN. The whole concept around that would be to enhance regional trade, but at the same time, to create a bloc which is identifiable by the products that it's produced within ASEAN, its identity by itself, and it's a community bloc, which some people ask, is it a bit like the European Union? Well, to a certain degree, yes, to a certain degree, no. But in its whole, I think, you know, the challenges that we see, although we see a lot of opportunities within the ASEAN community, as well as APSF working together with ASEAN, the challenge we always see is, as well as we mentioned earlier on, how do we break down trade barriers? How do we get through things like duties and tariffs? It's something which is very fundamental because it disrupts the whole process around efficiencies and around cost effectiveness. Now, what happens today is when you move any returnable packaging item across borders, as been mentioned, not only in Thailand, in all countries, what happens is you need to fill out forms, custom forms. You need to declare it as an export. And if you want to bring it back, you need to declare it as a re-import. Now, the process around that is, although there are blueprints around that, although there are standards or there are policies around that, but down to implementation, it's a totally different story. When you try and get through customs and borders, the understanding of it, and hence the implementation and execution of it, goes, you know, it's very, very ambiguous. And I think that's something that, you know, we need to work through in APSF, together with APSF, to try and make sure that, you know, those are the things that, you know, I know it's high on the priority list, all of us know. And in fact, with just like, you know, anyone who is a stakeholder in the whole process, it's very important that we get that right, because if you don't get that right, the whole process is not effective, neither is it efficient. And we talk a lot about, you know, having smart technologies around pallets itself. Now, we talk about RFIDs, and RFID is a very good system, but at the same time, obviously, there are limitations. And now we talk about IoT, you know, the Internet of Things. We say that that's the future. And companies now are coming up with what they say are smart pallets using IoT technology, which allows those smart tags or smart devices attached on a pallet or any shipping platform to be traceable via GSM or Wi-Fi technology. Now, what they say and what we tend to understand about it is that it benefits in the sense that you do not need to be within certain networks, because it has its own artificial intelligence in it. It can sniff Wi-Fi from a certain range, it can identify that Wi-Fi location, it can identify the range, and it will become accustomed to it if it's moved there. Now, the good thing about it, they say, is that it uses very, very little energy. So a battery could last a life, rather many, many years. As opposed to, let's say, an active RFID tag. Limitations around that is if it goes within, let's say, certain walls or certain areas, it's not traceable, it's not trackable as well. So again, you know, there are various technologies out there, but at the same time, the price and technology, it also varies a lot. With the IoT technology that we have today, it's quite expensive in comparison to what you would pay for, let's say, a pallet itself. So the question always is there a cost benefit towards that? And you would hear, you know, again, different people, different companies saying, you know, different things. But ultimately, we believe that the cost of this technology would actually come down in future if we can get it to commercialize here. Now, what tends to happen now is with the shipment of certain items, say automotive parts, where it goes in metal containers, metal collapsible containers, there are business cases for it, because these are very high-valued items, and they tend to also carry high-value items in it. So if you have a metal container carrying, let's say, automotive parts, those are high-value items. Relative cost of that IoT tag to that equipment itself is very low. But then you talk about a pallet. A pallet that's like, you know, depends on how you want to look at it, $30 range upwards. And that technology itself could cost you $5 to $10. So would companies be willing to invest in that technology? Now, that's the question, that's the million-dollar question always, because for us, we believe that it will happen somewhere down the line. Now, how fast we get there, it's something which, you know, we want to work with industry stakeholders, we want to work with APSF to make sure that, you know, efficiencies around unit load systems, the efficiencies around standardization, efficiencies around shipment, around inter-regional trade, domestic country movements, the efficiencies around that can be realized as a whole. So that's what we aspire towards. And I think for all stakeholders, we aspire towards the same thing as well. It's just who can actually take the lead towards this. And there are many associations, as has been mentioned, many associations in countries within APSF itself trying to work towards you know, the same common goal. And for us, you know, we are fully supportive of these goals and we would work towards that. And at the same time, I think, you know, it's also what industry stakeholders want. I think Khun Surasit mentioned earlier on in his presentation that we've got his company has got customers who require a lot of standardization. A lot of customization. And customization works, it's good in certain ways, but at the same time, it also impedes upon the kind of efficiencies that could be gained from standardization. We know this because at the same time, apart from working with pallets, we work with a range of other equipments, different industries, even simple things like plastic crates. Go from one country to another country, standards are totally different. Go from one, let's say, buyer to one manufacturer, standards could be different as well. Next thing we also look at was roll cages, the thing that you actually move after you pick loose load items into a metal cage with rollers on it. Now, even with roll cages, totally different standards that we see. Now, all these are realities that we have within the operating environment in logistics today. The common goal that we aspire towards, we have to work through these challenges. Those are very important too. I think those are very important items to the industry as a whole. But I think, you know, for us here, you know, we are here to actually work with the right stakeholders. We are here to work with APSF, and we are here to work with all logistics associations to see that logistics practices are taken to the next step going forward. So thank you for your time.